Hello everybody, it's Dr. A. Welcome to History Surfer. I'm here making this video as a kind of a Q&A. This is the first time I've ever done this. If you like it, let me know. If you don't, let me know. But it's because I've been getting a lot of questions from people about how my trip to Egypt was, and I have a list of all of those. So I wanted to answer some of them for those of you who are considering going there. I know it's becoming very trendy right now to go there, so I'll tell you my experiences. The biggest question I always get from everybody I see when they're like, "What have you been doing?" I'm like, "I've been in Egypt. I went to Egypt over Christmas." And doing that, I get this question first: were you scared? Well, I have to tell you, I was slightly apprehensive on the way. I'd heard some bad stories, but I always wanted to go, and I decided that I was going to take a few steps to make it so that I felt more secure. So one of the first things that I always do when I go to a place like that, where I feel like there's going to be some issues, is I register with the State Department in the STEP program. It's an acronym. It stands for Smart Traveler Enrollment. I think it's registration. It's Smart Traveler Enrollment Program. It's STEP, but I couldn't remember for a second. And what it does is it tells the embassy in the country that you're at, where you're at, and what you're doing, like what hotels you're staying at. And so that way, if something does happen, they know where you're at, they have your phone number, your contact information, and so they can get a hold of you or maybe help you out if something does go wrong. I always feel that makes me feel a little more secure. Another thing I did, just from doing lots of research and reading and watching YouTube videos, of course, was I hired guides. As you saw in my videos, if you've been following my Egypt trip, I felt that that was a thing for me that worked. I didn't want to be in those places by myself. And it did help us out tremendously. Rindog and I felt very secure. The guides not only take you around, they keep the people off of you that are, you know, they're harassing you to buy stuff, but they also bring drivers with them. And the drivers have nice cars, and when you go on and off properties, like, they know the procedure for all the security. Like, for instance, when we came into our hotel every time, in Cairo, especially where we're in Giza, they would come with a bomb detecting unit almost. It was a guy. I mean, he was always there. There was always one there. And they had a bomb sniffing dog. And they also had one of those mirrors that they put underneath the body of the car. And so they checked that, and then they checked the trunk. The driver would always open the trunk. So it felt very secure to us. And there's lots of tourist police around. They're there to help you. Granted, you know, I don't know how that works. We didn't have any problems. I never flash anything, money. I don't travel with, you know, expensive jewelry. Now, I do have my cameras, but they're always on my backpack. And I put that on the front sometimes if I feel like that's a necessary thing, or I hold it in my hand. But again, with the guide, I felt pretty safe. Another thing in the same mode was, did I have to cover my hair? Well, if you've watched the videos, you know I didn't have my hair covered ever. And the guide we had in Cairo said specifically, you don't have to. So I had been prepared with that for that. I had bought a scarf, but I actually never did it. It was beautiful in the day, and in the morning when it was cold, I wore those scarves around my neck. And it was kind of like, it was dual purpose anyway, so it didn't bother me. Another question a lot of people ask me is, how did I book my trip? Well, I booked it all myself. I have had experience a little bit, and I was a travel agent in the past. It was a long time ago, but over the years, I have learned more and more of the insides and outs of booking things. The hardest thing is planning all the dates, and so I print calendars. I don't like to see things big, and then I start to figure out how long it'll take me to get from one place to another. I read tons of reviews. Always remember there's going to be good reviews and bad reviews. And I also, for this trip, for my choice of hotels. Again, I was thinking about, you know, some of the things I had heard. I went ahead and I booked some very choice properties that were very high rated and four-star, one, and five-star, actually. I paid more money, I know that, but it was worth it to me. Mena House in Cairo, I had no doubts that that was a very secure place. There was a big wall around the property. There were tons of security people around. Everyone there was very professional. I would highly recommend that. Plus, it's right next to the pyramids. I mean, you eat breakfast and you can see the Great Pyramid. So for me, that was a bonus. I also use booking.com a lot. I like that travel site. It gives me a lot of choices. I also use Google a lot. I also booked the guide. I actually used Viator this time, but you can do Go Local. There's a lot of other things. I only use Viator because I could earn points using that with my venture card, and I paid for a lot of those tours with those points. So that was a bonus for me. Did another thing someone asked me was, did all my bookings work out? For the most part, yes. I didn't have any problems. There were a few moments, like when the guide couldn't find us and we were in Luxor. My phone wasn't working so great because the Wi-Fi wasn't that great in the hotel. Not in all places, like in the room. I had to go to the lobby for that to work correctly because a lot of it's done through WhatsApp. I also had a bad experience with the arrival in Cairo. Our driver wasn't there because our plane was late. And so we had to haggle with the taxi drivers out in front of the airport. That's not fun for me. I know some people like to haggle, and if you're one of them, you can do it. You know, you just, what I did when I, you know, started the whole process was I had asked somebody on the plane, just in case, I was like, how much is it usually? And I just asked her, she was someone who'd been to Egypt a lot. And I just asked her, how much does it usually cost to get from the airport to Giza with a cab? So she had given me kind of a price. So I knew a little bit of a price. I would, though, in retrospect, because of our guide, I learned some other things. I would use Uber because when we came back from Luxor to Cairo, you fly there. You can go by train, but we chose to fly. That was another choice I made. Flying from Cairo down to Luxor is about an hour. By train, if you go the overnight train, you're talking overnight. So we're talking 12 hours, I think it was. I did look into it, but we chose to go by plane. And when we came back from Luxor to Cairo, I used Uber. On her recommendation, and she was absolutely correct, it was much more reasonable and it was not a problem. And so I would definitely recommend using Uber. That was really the only bad thing that happened as far as someone not showing up. All the guides were there, they wait for you in the lobby, they contact you, some of them. It's well worth it to me. And it varied in price, some of the things, because we chose to be by ourselves, just Randog and I, because I was doing a lot of filming and I wanted to take lots of pictures, because I take a lot of pictures. I'm a photographer, I was a photography major, and so you'll see that in my video that there's a lot of still shots in there. That's why I'll address that too. I have that as one of my questions. Thing with having your own guide is you can set the pace. Like when we went to the Valley of Kings, I mean, we were there for a long time and the guide waited for us. I don't know if he was happy, but he was a nice guy and he didn't complain. He called himself King Ahmed. I would highly recommend him. I have him in my video and I put his contact information. But if you need any of that, just send me a comment. I'm happy to answer. That was like the hardest thing, you know, was the transfers and getting around. But for the most part, it wasn't that terrible. Another thing that people ask me, I'm looking at a list I made because I keep getting these questions. How was the food? Well, it's really good. If you like Mediterranean food, Egypt is very much in that same genre, if you will, in food. Lots of falafel. I ate a lot of Mediterranean food. Eggplant, roasted eggplant, falafel. Now, Randog's not a big fan of all that stuff. So, luckily, they make accommodations, especially in your hotel. If you're going to, you know, stay in the hotel and eat, which we did a lot in Luxor, because I had asked, this is what I always do. We always ask locals, where would you eat? And one guy told us, and a couple people said, eat in your hotels, unless you're getting something like street food, falafel food. You know, they had that in Luxor that was really good. The falafels there are delicious. If you like falafels like I do, they make them with fava beans instead of chickpeas. So it's different, but it was really good. And everything is really fresh. Egypt's like the breadbasket of Africa, I would say. Now, I can't say that definitively. You know, the only thing I can say is Cairo is the largest city in Africa as far as Egypt in the rest of Africa. But I can tell you, we saw tons of fresh food being brought into market every day, everywhere we went. They have lots of very good fresh food. I didn't eat a lot of meat, so I don't really know about that. I can tell you that Randog ate a lot of grilled meat on like a kebab style stuff. And he loved that in our hotel in Luxor, we stayed in the Steigenberger Nile Palace, which was really nice. People were great. They had a great breakfast. Waffles and that kind of stuff, which he prefers. So I have to give him credit. He does try, but he's not an adventurous eater. And my last question, and again, if you have any others you want me to answer, just, you know, leave them in the comments so I can address them for you. But that the last one I kind of already started. Why are my videos so artsy? I know I watch a lot of YouTube stuff, and I realize that my stuff tends to be a little artsy looking. Well, I was an art major. I teach art history and art appreciation, and I am a photographer. So I do have that as kind of my thing. I like to make things look beautiful and interesting. And I think about views and I plan shots specifically based on design principles. I mean, I am thinking about that. It's not random for me a lot of the time. So yeah, it looks artsy because I'm artsy and I'm nerdy and I have too much information. But I hope that this, I didn't want to make this too long. I hate talking in front of people, although that's what I do for a living. You'd think I would like it, but I'm not a big fan of filming myself. I'm a photographer. I want to take pictures. I don't want to be in them, so you don't see me a lot. So these are big deals for me. But if you have any questions, I hope this answered some of them. If you're thinking about traveling to Egypt, someone asked me, would I do it? Absolutely, I would go. I would go again, actually. I just heard from our first guide, Nahed, that they had opened the new museum, and I would love to go and then go down to Aswan because we didn't make it down there. But if you're there or you're thinking about going there, enjoy yourself, enjoy the food, enjoy the people. I really loved it. I have to say, it's a trip of a lifetime. So have fun, and I hope that you like this. This is my first attempt at a Q&A. Peace out, everybody. I'll see you later.